Welcome to Biology and Bioengineering Summer Camp, BBSC 2021.
Hello students. Welcome to Biology and Bioengineering Summer Camp 2021. In this pre-session of this particular summer camp, today we are going to talk about a very interesting biological question and a very serious issue: how to combat the second wave of COVID-19 in India. So last year, BioLab at IIT Bombay, which primarily works on proteomics and proteomics-based applications, took several projects on COVID-19 investigations. And I'm just giving you a nutshell, first of all, that what work we've done in our lab. And then I'll come to today's issues about the second wave. So from those patient samples of nasopharyngeal swab, we tried to develop a new test based on the peptides of SARS-CoV-2 virus. Can we detect those peptides in mass spectrometers? And looking at different proteins from the spike protein, nucleoprotein, and replicase polyproteins, we were able to develop a test based on 11 peptides of these three proteins. The work was presented and also published in the Cell Press Journal iScience. We also looked at the plasma samples of these COVID-19 patients, which are having either mild infection or the severe infection, and try to look at the protein level, can we predict that what is the mechanism going on, which is changing from the non-severe to the severe group of patients. And few proteins which are shown here, which we develop as a test, based on angiotensinogen, apolipoB protein, fibrinogen gamma chain protein, and certain proteins, they showed huge change in the severe group of patient. And this work was also patented and published recently in Frontiers of Physiology. Based on various investigation, omics technology, looking at either proteins or metabolites, we were able to find out different triggers, different mechanism, which is driving the severity of the disease. And this work is still communicated and patent being filed. And finally, based on these knowledge, what we acquired, we found that if we can take some of these target proteins and dog them with different type of known drug targets, FDA approved drugs, can they be used for the drug repurposing? And one of the leads shown here, selinexor, showed quite promising result by inhibiting different proteins which are involved in the severity of the patients. So this work is still under review. Based on these, some of the the recent work which we conducted at IIT Bombay from India side, Nature invited me to give a talk, a webinar last month, and that was to display various activities ongoing in COVID-19 research using proteomics technologies. So with this brief introduction, let me come to some very basic questions and some very basic explanation in more layman terms. Given the all of you are at very young age, at very different stage of your career, what I thought, let's revisit the whole problem and try to increase the awareness about this particular disease, and also how together we can try to at least make some control, if not completely eradicate this problem. So let us just try to understand the basics of how this infection happens. And I'm not going to give you great detail about the biology of it, which you have already been studying. But just to give a quick snapshot of the disease progression, after the viral infection, it takes at least 4 to 5 days of median time for infection to the onset of the symptoms. And now let's say this is the day zero when the symptoms starts appearing. And then it takes almost 14 days cycle for the all the various complications which you see happening. So initially the symptoms are mild, and the patient is having fever, dry cough, shortness of breath, fatigue, muscle pain, etc. And then during this time of 5 to 7 days, most of the patients which are actually only having mild symptoms, with medication, they will start to see some diminishing of these symptoms. But some patients, they will actually still see the severity of the disease, and that is going to reach to the lung, that could actually create more complications. And those are the severe group of patients which are currently facing a lot of problem of difficult breathing and many issues which you are hearing right now of shortage of oxygen and ventilators. All those are linked to this. So what you have to keep in mind that there are certain days which are highlighted in the red dots here. Those are quite crucial here. And this slide, I would not like to go in detail. You are already aware by now that there are many symptoms which can alarm an individual that these symptoms could be related to the COVID-19. Although, you know, it is sometimes very confusing to distinguish the normal viral flu versus looking at a specific COVID-19. And that's where you need to go for the specific real-time PCR-based test. So while this first wave was already happening in India, and that was pretty much under control from last October, November onwards, all of a sudden what happened that, you know, this tsunami of second wave happened in India from March onwards, right? So the main reason for this is the various type of mutant forms of this particular SARS-CoV-2 strain. You might have already heard about that in UK, there was December onwards, there was a very high transmissible variant, which was B117, which was already identified. And as a result, UK was totally under lockdown. This strain actually also traveled to India, and many parts of India started reporting this particular variant. Additionally, in the global arena, you will see the South African variant, Brazil variant. There are some more recent coming California and New York variants. Many of those are showing that virus is doing a lot of mutations, and those variants of concern or VOCs need to be looked very seriously. Now, all of a sudden, there is an increase in the double mutant of this viral strain, B1617. And that was reported in Maharashtra patients of almost 60% or so. They showed that, there are at least two mutations, L452R and E484Q, which is highly prevalent in these patients. And these mutations are happening in the spike protein of the virus in the receptor binding domain. So as a result of this double mutation, this virus is able to bind much faster. It is able to grow much rapidly, and it is also able to reduce the neutralizing antibodies. So these things are really creating, the huge rise in the more patient, which you see in the second wave of COVID-19 from the March onwards. Question is, how to really think about controlling this particular viral infection and how to reduce this spread, which is very rapidly happening, right? So this is the cycle which we talked of, minus 5 days of incubation time and then symptom onset followed by the actual disease progression. So from the onset of symptom initially, first 2 or 3 days, people are experiencing some mild symptoms, which is, temperature, having some cough and cold issues, and those are once they realize that okay, they may have COVID-19, then they go for RT-PCR test. They have already lost 2 or 3 days time, and then by the time with the delayed turnaround time right now, they get a report, it's almost 5 or 6 days have gone by that time, and only this time now they are going to start the medication, which is after losing the crucial 5 or 6 days time. And many of the patients who are already having some breathless issues and other kind of comorbidity issues, they are displaying high dyspnea or shortness of breath. So this time when, from the day 1 to day 5, till this person start getting any antiviral medication, that person is super spreader because he is spreading the virus from, nearby all the family members to his friends, to the society, wherever he interacts. And unknowingly, does not know that he's already having this infection. And of course, it's also rising the infection in this individual unknowingly. So in some way, every patient is actually a bioreactor, which is a natural reactor where the virus is growing. And from individual A, now this time has been lost. And now this person has already spread to individual B. And now this is spreading to individual C. So unknowingly, we are, really increasing this chain reaction, and a lot of individuals are getting infected. So how to think about trying to control this problem, right? So first of all, rather than only relying on that to wait for RT-PCR test to be done. When you see any symptoms appearing, it's a good idea to go quickly for any rapid antigen test, which is more rapidly available. And even if the reports are not, exactly saying the, it is COVID-19, still, I think, if the symptoms are looking suspicious, with the clinicians, particular, consultation even on the telephone, it's actually a good idea to start medication early. And rather than starting after 5 or 6 days, if we can bring it down to after, 1 or 2 days, I think we can really control this particular problem a lot. So the second wave of virus, which we are thinking, we have learned enough from the first wave, and we are still trying to treat this, problem in the same manner. That is a major mistake which we are doing. This particular mutant virus is quite rapidly growing, so it does not give you so much time like the first wave. In the first wave, we used to get a week time to really think about, ascertaining that individual is really COVID positive with RT-PCR test, and some symptoms already happen. It's still, if you start medication, you can control that. But in the second wave, the virus is very rapidly growing, and therefore losing this crucial time window is actually the major problem which all of us are facing right now. So if we can reduce the treatment and start early medication, even with the unconfirmed reports at that time, I think that could be probably much better than to take the patient to the severe phase and then starting the actual treatment. So I have been working on the COVID-19 problem with along with many clinicians in Mumbai, different hospitals. And one of the clinician friend, actually, he recommended this medication, which has worked very well for many of even my friends and many of the known contacts who have really benefited a lot from this medication. So I just thought to give you at least some representative idea that what these medications are. Of course, it's a good idea for you to consult a clinician and take their advice prior to taking a medication. But this cocktail of mixture is very cheap. Hardly 300, 400 rupees is can actually cure COVID-19, and just if it is given on the right time. So if after looking at the initial symptoms, and if you are suspected and the medication could start early, so this drugs like ivermectin, that actually controls that controls viral growth, so it is an antiviral. It can stop the viral replication in vitro. Just 3 doses of this particular medicine alternate days can actually sufficiently control the virus if given at early stage when the viral load is very low. Doxycycline is another antimicrobial, anti-inflammatory drug, which is also works well to control other microbes. Along with these, clopidogrel, which is an anticoagulant, and dexamethasone, which is a corticosteroid, these are also given, which could actually continue from day 1 to day 14. So these two medicine will, be continued for 2 weeks, so that now the individuals can also, those who are seeing the post-COVID infection, certain cytokine storm and other symptoms, even those could be controlled, right? So in such a way, this is a very simple medication which could really help people to control the problems if given at the early stage. And of course, there are different combinations of the same, rationale could be used, different other antivirals, Flavipro, and then there is a remdesivir. Many things are available, but don't rely only on one drug which you think is the, the magic bullet. There is no magic bullet. Magic bullet is the time window. Early treatment, early medication is the magic bullet. And even the simple medication, which is affordable by anybody, could actually treat every individual quite rapidly, except some which are already having other complications. So other questions. So many of you who are already interacting with me and sending me emails are actually asking me these questions, and that actually triggered me and prompted me and motivated me to take this session and try to at least convey some of my own thoughts in my personal capacity. So some of you have asked about why there are more breathing issues seen, like, the COVID-19 was already in the first wave as well, but we had not seen this problem so much in the first wave, right? So I think, on one hand, I must say that this virus is very, very rapidly growing, and therefore we are not directly comparing from the first wave. Although virus remains same, but VOC variants of concern, the double mutants, they are quite different. So we cannot think about the same virus and treat them in the same manner. We are losing quite important time window, and that is increasing into the dyspnea and other kind of oxygen problems, right? So higher infectivity rate of this mutants is of concern, which is new thing. And after the infection happens, let's say after 7 days or so, after the viral infection has finished, then it triggers the immune responses and produces a lot of inflammatory factors, which are known as cytokine storms, which means it is essentially production of a lot of immune cells and cytokines in the lung. And there are several, I do not want to go in great detail about it because some of the audience is very younger here, but just to convey you, there are different molecules which are released, which are known as cytokines, which are mentioned here, some of these names. These are the molecules known as cytokines. They accumulate in the great abundance, and that is known as cytokine storm. And that results into pulmonary edema, dysfunction of the air exchange, and eventually in the more acute, in the severe cases, it results into the acute respiratory distress syndrome or ARDS. So if the disease has reached to this stage, it becomes very difficult to control. It means if you have lost the initial time window, it has progressed here, and now a sufficient cytokines storm is being produced. It is now going to drive the inflammatory reactions in the blood vessels. It's going to create more of the clotting, and therefore the poor oxygenation will happen in the body and going to reduce the SpO2 level. So all comes back to early medication. If that is being given, we can control a lot of these things, and a lot of overproduction of cytokine storm could be reduced. And as a result, probably the oxygenation could be well maintained throughout this type of treatment. So other question which some of you have asked me, which I do not know that I'm the right person to really comment on this. I'm not a policymaker, how to control the second wave. But of course, I'm going to give you my personal opinion that how best we should try to control this problem. I already gave you an analogy that, from the individual A to B and C, in this particular second wave, the major problem is if one person of a family gets infected, everybody of that family gets infected, because 2-3 days, you lose time to know that you are really infected. And during that time, of course, you cannot wear the mask all the time at home. So you are going to spread the disease to other family members. And that is what being seen very different this time, unlike previous time. Earlier, if one person is, getting infected, it's not spreading to all the family members. The person could be quarantined safely at home. This time, one person, being the viral growth very fast, can very rapidly infect others, right? So now as a result, we see the chain reaction happening, really huge spurt and a big rise of the COVID-19 patients. So I think, given the current situation, which is the extreme situation, that really demands extreme measures and extraordinary decisions to be taken. Of course, this sounds maybe a little difficult, but given that all the different states are imposing different type of partial lockdown, which is not effective, or effective to some extent, but not to the complete extent. As you can see, the numbers are still rising, 400,000 or so every day. And that is still going to continue if we cannot control this problem. So we need a complete shutdown for some time so that we can control this problem. And that is also going to give us let increase more awareness so that people can recognize the symptoms early. They should not let the disease go very severe form and start early medication, which is going to be key to control this problem. Even free cheap medication made available to all the rural parts of India, different people who cannot afford the medicines, should be given, rather than spending so much on making the ICUs and trying to reach to that stage. Why not try to control the problems at early stage and give people control the problem at the early stage? Having some complete lockdown except the medical infrastructure will give us also time to boost up the temporary hospitals and rapidly increase some of the things required for our medical facilities. And of course, that should be continued with the increased vaccine production, which will definitely, going to be helpful in the long term. And finally, I'd like to say that, we have not done enough of the genome sequencing. We have not understood the virus sufficiently. The way viruses, the sharp, fast, and must be, evolving so rapidly in the evolutionary pace, we are not able to gain knowledge in the same rapid pace. So therefore, there's more need for investing into research funding, infrastructure, and continued effort being given to the scientists so that we can make early predictions, we can make some more educated sense of trying to control this problem. So just to conclude these various points, which was most of the different questions which I have been getting from the students, and I thought to convey all of you my personal opinion about this. I'm sure you are reading about this particular second wave every day in all the newspapers. But essentially, I want to convey you that what we are working on right now is a slightly different virus, not same virus what we have seen in the first wave. This one is the first wave was the wild type strain of the Wuhan strain, much more slow growing. The second wave virus is much rapidly growing. And of course, our infrastructure of the testing as well as the medication has not been smart enough to outpace the virus. And therefore, we see the lagging and all the issues are happening. In most of the time, currently, all the travel restrictions are there. And everybody has to produce RT-PCR report before traveling. That is also reducing a lot of infrastructure for the actual patients who are in the queue of 3-4 days to get the report. And that is also increasing the number of infected patients on time. Of course, late medication for this fast growing virus is the major issue. If we could really try to save this crucial 4 to 5 days time, I think we can really control this virus. It's still very much within our reach. And a lot of issues which you see for the oxygen problems and various type of, SpO2 level going down. I hope you can now at least educate your family members, your friends, your society that let it not reach that stage. The first 5 days, 7 days are very crucial. After that, things are beyond your control and beyond our infrastructure's control currently. So extreme times requires extraordinary measures. All of you who are really at the very young age, and I consider all of you the young scientists, should work like the brand ambassadors, should work like the biology ambassadors of knowledge, who should spread this knowledge to your family members, to your society, and try to educate people and see how much your voluntary contributions can actually speed up and try to at least control this problem in your localities, in your society. And I think in that way, your biology knowledge can really make some impact to your society. That's all I think I have to say. But before I close, let me say that, while doing the COVID-19 research at IIT Bombay, a large number of PhD and postdoc and different students, JRFs, they have all been involved in various activities of investigations. And many clinicians, Dr. Jayanti Shastri, Dr. Sachi from Kasturba Hospital and Nair Hospital, Dr. Om Srivastava from the Sloak Hospital, Professor Subnis Max Faculty from IIT Bombay, Professor Michelle Hill from QIMR Australia. Many faculty members and large collaborative team have been involved in trying to gain some knowledge about this particular virus. And these are some of the news highlights and media coverage of some of our recent work done on COVID-19. But I'd like to close that it is really an important responsibility for all of us who understand the biology and medicine to really educate our society, to really try to convey this knowledge to at least our family, our friends, and to the smaller community where we live so that more people can be benefited. We can definitely make that first step towards trying to control this problem. And this is actually our obligation, our responsibility to really try to put our effort. And I'm sure together we can still win this race. Thank you very much.